Welcome one, welcome all, welcome to this newbie tutorial here for Hearts of Iron 4. I am Bridger from the Sound Strategy Network, Sound Strategy Network on YouTube, or Bridger. It's worth noting that this will be a very long, very slow, and very methodical look at the game's mechanics. If you prefer to just get a quicker overview, I have a pre-release guide that I put out earlier, which gives you a great overview of all the systems in the game, although not as detailed as this. If you prefer just a hints, tips, and tricks style video, I've got one of those as well. Links on the screen or in the description. And you can find a lot more educational and informational videos about Hearts of Iron 4 there, but I am joined today for this tutorial by my good friend Mark. Welcome, Mark.
Yeah, hi, Bridger. I'm really excited about this tutorial.
All right, so Mark, you have not really looked into Hearts of Iron 4 at all. You're going to be a standard, stand-in proxy for the audience, as it were, here. I'm going to be explaining the game to you, and if I'm going too fast, you need to interrupt me because I'm very bad at stopping. So feel free to interrupt me whenever I'm talking too much and ask a question, because we want to make sure we cover everything as much as can be. So with that, let's jump into the game. So we're going to click on a new game here. The game actually has two options to start with, 1936 or 1939. Both have the historical starting situation in World War II. So 1936 gives you a little control over the beginning of ramping up to the war. You can change some things from history and do things your own way. 1939, on the other hand, gives you the historical start to the war. Germany is poised to attack Poland. The Allies are poised to respond. Russia is waiting in the wings, etc., etc. But we're going to start in the 1936 start because the in-game tutorial does start in the 1936 start because Italy is a good choice to start with. They will need to use all three branches of the military, ground, air, and naval, whereas if you play, for example, the Soviet Union, you can kind of ignore your navy and get away with it. But Italy will force you to play all three. In addition, you don't have to wait 3 or 4 years for a war. Italy starts in a war with Ethiopia, so we can learn the war mechanics right off. So let's click Italy. We'll click Start. There's a couple different difficulty levels here. We'll be playing on regular because I've got my teeth cut on this game already, but you can start in the recruit level of difficulty, which gives you some advantages in production and research, and then you can also play in the veteran level, which hampers your production and research as well as political power gain. For those of you unaware, Iron Man mode is a mode that allows you to basically the game forces you to avoid what's called save scumming. This is where you would play, and if you make a major mistake, you reload from an earlier save. Iron Man mode prevents that. You're not allowed to save manually, and it saves on a monthly basis, overwriting the previous save, so that you can't possibly go back more than a few days. So if you make a giant mistake, you gotta live with it. That's Iron Man mode. So if you want to play in super hardcore mode, you can do that. Historical AI focuses. There's a set of things in the game called national focuses, which will help you decide how you want your country to pursue its goals. And you could weight those national focus choices by the AI to be more historical. The AI will take historical decisions. So for example, when Germany reoccupies the Rhineland, the France AI and the United Kingdom AI get options. Do you want to challenge Germany? The historical options were, of course, no. They were appeasement. They were, oh, just let them do it. It's just the Germans walking in their backyard. But if you want a more ahistorical game, you can uncheck this option, and then the weighting that makes things more likely to go historical goes away, and the AI will simply choose things that it thinks is best. So we're going to play with historical just for now, and we're going to jump into the game. Loading graphics. Here we are. And you can see we can zoom way out and see the whole of the world lay out here before us. The Soviet Union, of course, the giant monstrosity that it is. Japan and the many Chinas. Over the course of the game, of course, if Japan goes to war with China, they'll all combine against the oppressors. You've got France, the major powers in the game, I should point out. France, United Kingdom, Germany, the Soviet Union, Italy, United States, and Japan. They all have unique national focus trees, and they all have some unique artwork in their research trees that look pretty cool. So we can take a quick look at that. For example, if we go into the tank designs, you can see these little tank designs are unique for Italy. And America would have like a Sherman tank here, and the Germany will have a Panzer III and a Panzer IV. So those are kind of nice little historical nods. But how are we going to learn how to play this game, Mark? We're going to learn to play this game by first learning how to use the military, then how to produce the military, and then why we use the military. The big, the high-level stuff. What are we doing this for? The answer to that, by the way, is resources, but we're going to get there. So let's start by learning how to use the army. You can see here we've got Ethiopia, and we've got our little incursion on the top section of Ethiopia and the bottom section of Ethiopia here. And, I'm sorry, Mark, I'm so rude. We need to make you more comfortable here. You're a longtime wargamer, right? We can go into here and click on this. Ah, there we go. See that? Now you're feeling a little more at home, right?
We got
X's. We got
infantry,
X's with little
right,
dots.
Right.
No, so I just wanted to show off, yes, the game does in fact have NATO counters. That is one of the most asked questions on the forums anywhere, but for the purposes of this, I'm going to leave it on default. And let's look. So what we're seeing here on these cards is we've got a little helmet, means we've got an infantry division, and we've got five of them. Then the little symbol on the right-hand side that looks like a shield means they are defending. If we give them a movement order, you can see it changes to an arrow because they're moving. If we give them an attack order, they'll get the arrow with a little breaks in it showing that they're attacking. So that is their current order. And if we zoom out, you can see they all sort of combine together. And it says there's five infantry divisions here. There's three infantry divisions here and one mountain division here. Mountain divisions are, of course, better at fighting in the mountains. They have special training and equipment for that. And then we've got, looks like, five total infantry divisions here in the south. So, just like any other real-time or even turn-based game, you can select units. Let's say we just want to select this guy and right-click. And I have the game paused right now, so he's not going to start moving. But if I unpause it, you'll watch as this little progress bar, actually it's going to go very slowly because this is mountainous terrain. It takes a long time for him to get anywhere. So if we hover over him, for example, it says it'll take 2 days and 7 hours for him to get to this other province. And it's slowly ticking down. You can also see there's a small skull in the corner. He is taking 50% attrition while moving. You can see the other units are not taking attrition. If you move, you take attrition due to the terrain and weather in your situation. If you just stand still, you don't take that attrition. So, for example, if you're in Russia in the winter, stop attacking. Do not proceed. Do not pass go. Do not collect 200 dead bodies. All right, so right-click, you can move, guys. But this is easy. Oh, I started a fight. I didn't mean to start a fight. There we go. I paused the game again, so we're on January 4th now. We went through 3 days. As you can see in the top corner here, the game sinks forward in hourly segments, so 1900, 2000, et cetera, et cetera. So if...
Excuse me, can I ask how fast that goes each
hour? You can
hour?
Set it. You can see I've got two pips here. I can slow it down one. So if we see one, it goes 20, 21,
okay,
22.
About every 3 seconds.
Or we could speed it up to this, and it's going, whoa, it's flying by. Okay. We don't want to go that fast. And I know, by the way, you want to know something funny? Right now, there are people out there that are knowledgeable about the game whose heads are exploding because we have all of these icons across the top of the screen that we haven't dealt with yet. Calm down, guys. We're not trying to win. I recognize we're playing suboptimally. It's fine. We're just learning the game. Okay. So, here's the thing. While you can manually give orders to every one of your troops, I want you to attack here, I want you to attack here, I want you to attack here, and then we go down here, I tell you to do this, I tell you to do this, I tell you to do this. All of those things are possible, but while it's easy enough to do with these, like, six groups of units here, imagine trying to do that on the Eastern Front. Look how many provinces there are. If you wanted to go and manually give an order to every single one of these units, you could. You could pause the game, give an order to every single unit, unpause the game, wait until somebody makes some progress, then pause it again, but that would just be tedium. And we call that Hearts of Iron 3. But there's a new system that helps you, that allows you to essentially get some help from the AI. And it's called the Battle Plan system. So when you're using your land armies, let's select all of these guys up here. We're going to create an army out of them. So we select all them, then we can right-click on this new army button at the bottom of the screen. There we go. We've just created an army, but he lacks a leader. So we're going to click on this portrait up here and give them a leader. And here you can see some of the historical leaders that were available to Italy at this time. But, these guys aren't very good. Look at that. They've got the old guard trait. These are the guys that studied World War I tactics and still think that's the new hotness. Their experience gain is minus 25%. We don't want to use those guys. This guy's pretty good. Look at this. General Giovanni Messi. He's even got a special trait, Panzer Leader. Unfortunately, we don't have any Panzers, but, you know, he's also our best leader right now. He's got a skill of 4, which means for every level of skill, your units perform 5% better at attack and defense. We should probably choose him. In addition, you can see as a general, as opposed to a field marshal, he has the ability to get to command up to 24 divisions. If he commands more than 24, he will be essentially overstretched in his capabilities as a general. Field marshals get extra staff and all kinds of stuff. We could promote him to field marshal and allow him to command an infinite number of units. But if we do that, he loses his special trait and he loses a skill level, because it's a different set of skills to command as a field marshal. But we're going to start just by choosing him. We could also choose a new commander, but that's expensive in political power. And the new commanders all start as level 1s. Okay, so we have ourselves a leader, and he's got these units as his group. You can see that they are in his group because of the color. They've got that little green tinge on the right-hand side. We can change that color. What color would you like it to be?
Can we make it sort of a blue?
Blue. There it is. It's a dark blue. You want a lighter blue?
Blue-green. A little bit.
Bluish-green. Let's do bluish-green.
Yeah, that reminds me of the Italians, yes.
Aha. There we go. That's like an aquamarine.
All right.
Like that. All right. And why don't we, because these guys are all part of the same war, let's actually make these guys with a different army just for the explanation purposes. So we don't have another really good general, but we'll give these guys to General Sebastiano Visconti. And we might do this because when these generals have units under them that are fighting, they gain experience. And they may gain traits based on the type of fighting that's happening. If you're fighting in the mountains, the general might gain a mountain fighter trait. If you're fighting in the desert, they might gain the desert fox trait, where they become better at that specific type of terrain or the specific types of conditions that they're in. So you can see at the top right here, we need to change the color of these bottom guys. They should be something else. How about this blue? Uh-huh. So we've got the two different armies that we've made up here. We can even name them. What would you like to call the Southern Army? Just call it Southern Army. Do you want to come up with a cool name?
No, Southern Army's good.
Oops, I should actually type in the S. So you just type in right there whatever you want to call them. And then we can do the same thing for the Northern Army. Keep it easy to remember.
Yep.
And this way, whenever if we ever get confused about which one of these guys, because sometimes you'll have 5 or 10 down here, you just hover over it. Oh, that's the Northern Army. It says so right there. And this is the Southern Arm, apparently. I can't spell.
I thought you just ran out of room.
No, apparently not. I think it's pretty big. Okay, so now we've got that. Now, if we, for example, want to go up and look in our theater up here in Italy, we could also make an army for these guys. But we don't want to keep them all together. We want to organize them a little better. So let's say this is the Italian theater. That's fine. We'll rename it. We'll just leave that as Italian theater. That's our home theater. But for these guys fighting down in Ethiopia, they should be in a separate theater, so it's easy to organize them. And we can call that the Ethiopian theater.
Mm-hmm.
If I even spelt Ethiopian right. I'm just going to hope I did. Is that right?
Ethiopia.
Close enough. Nope, I need an I in there somewhere.
Yeah.
There we go. Bingo. So, we've got these theaters. And that helps us organize our armies. You can name them whatever you want. You can make as many theaters as you want. I could make a new theater down here. You're just right-clicking, by the way. Right-click on this, and whatever you have selected will go there to move your guys around. And you can see the number there represents the number of divisions that they have. And these theaters and things are just for land armies. They're not for your air forces or naval forces. So this is strictly for that. All right? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I'm looking at those question marks over there for slots. I don't know what's going on with that, and I don't know.
Oh, on the left-hand side. Yes.
Yeah, right there.
We will get to those when we get to production. Those represent the buildings that can be built in this area, partly based on the infrastructure that the area has. Mm-hmm. Okay, and the population. So Now that we've got our units in an army, we've got a problem because these guys have a little exclamation point. By the way, in this game, hovering over things usually gives you a lot of great information about what it is and why it's there and how you use it. So this says, the division belongs to an army but has no orders assigned, so let's fix that. So we'll select these guys up here, and the first thing that you want to do when you need to give some orders to your troops is you have to tell them where to line up, on what border will they be fighting. So you can hit this button right down here, frontline. Ignore the first two, this is naval invasion and paradrop, we're going to get to those later potentially, but frontline. So we click on this, and then we can right click and drag along a border, and you can see it's forming a front line there, and it's green. If we dragged along a border that was longer, and we kept dragging and dragging and dragging and dragging, it would start to turn yellow to indicate, hey, you don't have enough divisions in the selected army to man this border. And then when it turns red, it's saying, hey, you've got holes in this border if you want to make it this long. You need to add more divisions. So as an example, I can see if I can find one in the north that will do that for us. This will definitely do it, I think. We can say this border here. No, it's still staying green because they're ginormous provinces, but we do have a lot of guys selected. So that's the idea, is you'll see the color change to warn you if you're making a border too wide for the number of units that you have selected. Another option is you can just right-click on the border. That's actually not what I meant to do. Sorry. You actually left-click on the border, and it will make a border with the entire country that you selected.
I see.
It didn't make a border with the UK over here. We could make a separate border with the UK, with the same group. And then I could say, okay, you four guys, you're going to man this border, and you guys are going to man this border. So now the units will automatically spread out, and you can see in this got 10 divisions assigned to this from the Northern Army. And if we look at this border, it says four divisions assigned to this.
All right,
so you can see we've got the units automatically moving to try and fill in this border. This is the AI helping you out. You don't have to go, oh, I've got, you know, 16 provinces along this border. I've got 18 divisions to man it. Okay, I've got to put this one here, this one here, this one here. It'll automatically do it for you. But for the purposes of this, let's select all these guys and hold down Control and click on this border. So now all 14 are assigned to this border. I'm going to delete this border now. And because we're fighting with the Ethiopians, we're not worried about the United Kingdom at the moment. Sure. They are not our enemies, and they are not likely to be our enemies, so we don't have to worry about them. So the AI now will automatically have these guys move and spread out along this border. In fact, it only thinks that we need to move one of our guys here to fill the border out properly. And I believe it takes into account defensiveness of the border. So if, for example, this was a mountain territory and these two were plains, mountains much easier to defend, so it would put fewer units there and put more units on the plains. It is intelligent about how it moves and spreads its units out. So now that we've got a front line, that's very useful if we wanted to defend. It'll help us spread out our armies. But what if we wanted to attack? Well, down here, the next option is offensive line. This can get as complicated or as simple as you want. We could do an offensive line. Of course, it looks like our goal is to capture the capital here. So we could do an offensive line and drag like this. And again, you see how it's going from yellow to red?
Yes.
It's because I only have one division assigned. It's saying, yeah, one division could maybe capture out to here. But once you get to here, one division can't do that. So if I instead select everyone, now I do this. Now you can see it's green. Because it's like, oh yeah, with 14 divisions, we can definitely perform this plan. So there we go. I've created a rudimentary plan that involves these units slowly advancing as just a single, and you can hold over this, by the way, and it shows you what the AI is planning to do.
I see.
So that's the plan. You can also right-click and drag to have them try to, like, flank around. So now if we hover over it, you can see it'll grab that left-hand side first and primarily, and then it'll kind of ring back around. You can also make a much more complicated plan. Let's try doing something more interesting. So let's create a front line that's just this space over here, and a front line that's just this space. Oops, I did it again. And a front line that is here, and a front line that's there, and a front line that's there. Now we can assign these three to, oops, to this. We could assign these guys to this one, and these guys to this one. Now we can make a couple of different plans. We could have, let's see, these guys swing up to here, and then we could have them swing around to here and have these guys assigned to this order. And then we could have these guys. Let's do something like, nope, we don't want that. We could do this. And then those guys also swing around like this. So we've just kind of essentially surrounded the enemies that we have here so that we can cut them off and take them apart. And then the guys in the middle, of course, would perform like a holding action. Let's have them go basically to there. Bingo. So now we've made a very complicated plan, which is unnecessary for such a small area. But for example, if these outside units were panzer or mechanized armies, and you wanted them to break through the enemy line and surround Minsk or Kursk or whatever you wanted to do, and have the guys in the middle be infantry that perform a holding action to pin the enemy in place, then you could cut them off from supply, and it would be a much more interesting and advantageous way of going about things. Meanwhile, I'm just going to go back to our bog standard push forward with one giant wave, because this is mountainous terrain and we don't have any awesome panzer armies. We're not going to be doing any special mobilization secret cool moves. So instead, we're just going to do that. And we're going to assign all of these guys to that plan. And then we'll give these guys a front line down here as well. And we'll give them the plan to come in from the other direction. So now we've got both of them meeting in the middle at the capital. So, we've got our plan, which is good. And we're going to try to use it, but there's something we should consider. And actually, we should drag, because we want to come in from the left specifically. We don't need to come in from the left. We can come in from the center. There we go. And if you hover over this and then hold shift. Oops, hang on. You're moving the mouse on me. Hold shift, it shows you...
Oh, yeah, sorry, let me get rid of it. Hands off the mouse.
There you go. It shows you what it prioritizes. The black area is the primary prioritized place that it's going to go after first. So that's kind of a cool piece of information if you hover over it and hold shift. Anyway, now that we've got this plan, I'm going to let time start ticking. And if we hover over and select these units here, they're repositioning themselves. Oh, hang on. I did that incorrectly now that I look at things. Because I did not properly extend this back over here. There we go. Now it's correct. Okay, now I'm going to let time start ticking. We're going to take a look at the statistics of the units on the left-hand side. The green bar indicates their organization. So when units fight, you're doing damage to both the enemy manpower and their equipment takes damage, but also their organization, which represents essentially their morale, but also just how organized they are. If they lose a lot of officers, they become disorganized, for example, et cetera, et cetera. When the organization drops to zero, the unit is forced to retreat. If it doesn't matter if it's on the offense or the defense, organization determines when the unit is exhausted, it can't fight anymore, it has to retreat and regroup. The brown bar next to it is their fighting strength. That includes not only men, but also equipment. So if panzers are breaking down because you're fighting in harsh, marshy terrain, for example, or muddy terrain, the panzers take additional high attrition in muddy terrain, then the equipment starts to suffer, and you need to send in replacements and replacement equipment and parts and things like that. So the strength directly modifies the fighting capabilities of the unit. So we can see this unit's at full strength, but these units that have been moving around, they've been taking attrition. So they are down some equipment here. And they are waiting for replacements to arrive. So 14 infantry equipment needs to be produced and delivered to the front here. And that's all taken care of in the background, and we'll get to that later. But that means they're at 90% strength, so when they attack, their attack and defense numbers will be reduced by 10%. And then you have the unit type. You can see we've got the mountain division, et cetera, et cetera. You have their experience level. So our units here, we've got some regulars, which give them a 25% bonus in combat. We have some trained units, which give a 0% bonus, neither a penalty nor a bonus in combat. And then you have some green units. This is a minus 25% modifier in combat. But don't worry, those guys will learn quick, and they will stop being green. But for the first little while, they're going to take some heavier casualties as a result. Then next to that, we have the experience progress towards the next level. So trained, they're about 50% progress towards the next level. Next to that is the reason we came to this window. Plan preparation bonus. The default is that this increases by 2% each day. We've had time ticking for a while, so they've made it up to 38% plan preparation. Mm-hmm. So we made this battle plan. Meanwhile, all of the staff of these divisions have been coordinating and planning. Okay, well, this is the terrain that we have to face. Let's recon it. Let's send the plane over. Okay, we know this. We know that. We know this is their force distribution. We know this. And max is 50% in the current situation. Technologies and other things can improve that. Mm-hmm. So we're going to wait until we get to 50%. You don't necessarily have to in this opening thing because the enemy is so technologically inferior. Let's look at their units right now. They have maybe 60% equipment. You can see in that little brown bar there. So they don't have full equipment, and their equipment is going to be much weaker than ours. It's going to be like World War I level equipment. We've got World War II level equipment, essentially. So we should be able to, and we've also got better doctrines and things in them. We should be able to plow through them. We'll see. But we are now at a 50% planning bonus. I'm going to pause it there. The next button over here is entrenchment. If your unit sits still for a while, this entrenchment bar fills up. If they are attacked, the entrenchment bonus will be applied to their attack and defense, I believe. Or maybe just their defense. And then this is their name. So that's what all of these different things are. So the blue bar here is entrenchment. This blue bar is the plan preparation bonus. Now that we've made this plan and we have essentially waited for a while, it's built up. So now when we attack, we will get a 50% bonus to our attack and defense. And that will slowly decay over time because no plan survives contact with the enemy. So the more we move and fight with this plan, the lower that bonus will decay. So if you're making your way across the Russian steppe, for example, eventually you're going to want to stop because your planning bonus is gone. And so if you're making good headway, don't stop, I should say. But if the enemy starts getting stiff resistance and you meet a second line, a second defensive line, you might want to stop and make a new plan and then engage it after you've got a planning bonus to give you a boost to your attack.
I see. And if I understand you correctly, there would also be logistics-related losses of attrition that you might also need to stop for as well.
Correct. Okay. So what it looks like they've actually started to make an offense against us. You can see this little green thing here. The green indicates that we are winning this combat. The arrow indicates the direction of the attack. It means these guys are attacking into this province. Green indicates we are winning the battle. And the 43 represents the current situation of the battle. The closer it gets to 100%, the closer we are to winning. The closer it gets to 0%, the closer we are to losing. So that is the case,
okay,
no
I'm
matter whether it's attack or defense. The 43, right where my cursor is?
Oh, here? There it is now. I see it.
So 43% towards winning, but that could go back to zero if we start losing, and then when it gets to zero, we're forced to retreat. So we can click on that and get more detailed information about the battle. On the top here, you can see it's taking place in hills. This means the attacker has essentially a 30% penalty to their attack value. They only get 70% of their total attack. It also means enemy air support is weaker because hills are harder for them to see and fight in. And the movement cost within this terrain type is increased by 50%. So it takes 50% longer to move through it. Then you can see the leaders on each side. You can see the current battle progress. This is the 43% that we were looking at earlier. Right. And under that, you can see the generals have certain tactics. The Ethiopian general actually has Desert Fox. So he gets bonuses to fighting in desert, which if he was fighting on the lower section of Ethiopia, I think is desert, but this is hills instead. We have Panzer Leader, which doesn't apply to us, unfortunately, because we have no Panzers. And next, let's skip these for now. We'll come back to those. We have Skill 2. He's a Skill 2 leader, so he's got 10% attack and defense. We have Skill 4, 20% attack and defense. And then it shows all our divisions that are currently engaged. The width of this combat is 120. That is the default combat width, which is how many men you can fit onto the front line. When you're fighting in a mountain pass, if you think of the movie 300, right? The 300 Spartans at Thermopylae, they forced the Persians with their huge numbers to fight in a very small mountain pass to take advantage of their superior combat power and to negate the advantage of the numbers that the Persians provided. So if you're fighting in very bad terrain, for example, marsh or mountains, this number gets lower. It goes from 120 to 80, I believe, is the standard for mountains. And so that makes it harder for numerically superior enemies to fit on the front line. The number here is the current combat width of all of our units that are on the front line. If we had more units here, they'd be forced to go into the reserve. Well, not necessarily because it's only 72. Once we get up near 120, new units that would put us over 120 would stay in the reserves. They would not be fighting. They would replace our units that were forced to retreat, but they couldn't add their bonuses. So that is a situation to consider. Always, when you're looking at battles, if you're trying to figure out if you're winning or losing, do you have a bunch of units sitting in reserve because they can't get into the battle? That's something to consider. In this case, both units, both of our sides fit everybody into the front line, no problem. We don't have any reserves. So then we can look here and see, okay, the soft attack, hard attack. Just ignore the hard attack for now because we have no armor. So soft attack is 17. He's going to make 17 attacks at us every tick of the battle, every hour. We have 269 defenses. That means whenever he makes an attack, we lose a defense, and he has like a 10% chance of hitting us. But if he exhausts all of our defenses, let's say we had 30 defenses and he had 31 attack, the last attack, instead of having a 10% chance to hit us, would have a 40% chance to hit us. So the number of defenses we have indicates how many of those attacks we can absorb and essentially have a very low chance of them hitting us. Once they have more attacks than we have defenses, then they start hitting us more. And you can see that's the exact situation that we have. We have 68 soft attacks every tick, and these guys have 14 or 6 defenses. And that is partly because the breakthrough value of infantry is essentially their defense when attacking. If we were to attack, we would use our infantry's breakthrough value as well to absorb their hits. So breakthrough is defense when you're on the attack. Does that make sense?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, of course. Mm-hmm.
So when you're looking at the statistics of a unit, defense is usually much higher than breakthrough. Armor, on the other hand, has a higher breakthrough than it has a defense, because it's able to strike through the enemy line and do a bunch of damage where they're not expecting it to be. It's very mobile, but its mobility is its advantage. When you're on the defense, you can't be as mobile. You can't be as reactive. So usually armor has lower defensive values than it has breakthroughs. I don't know how historically accurate that is. It's just the way the game mechanics currently work. You throw some motorized infantry in with your army armor, however, and now you've got a much better capability to defend. So your panzer army sometimes should include some motorized or mechanized infantry to add defensive value to them. So that is how the combat statistics work. Hard attack is exclusively for when you're fighting armored units, essentially, so we can ignore that because there's no armored units on either side. Now let's take a look at the other things here. We have an advantage because we are the defender. So our attack and defense go up because of the terrain. And we also have this entrenchment bonus. Our attack and defense go up because we're entrenched. They, on the other hand, have a terrain penalty. They are also crossing a river, which is giving them a big penalty. So some of their units are crossing a river. You can also scroll down and see, wow, they have a bunch of units here, but they're so ineffective because they have the terrain penalty, but they also have much lower quality equipment. And if you look, these guys don't even have full equipment at all. They don't have... They have 45% strength.
Okay, so one wonders why the AI is having these guys attack, given all of these horrible...
Well, the borders... Part of the thing here is they don't know how strong we are until they attack. They'll probably call the attack off.
It's a probing attack.
It might be a probing attack. Because this side that currently has initiative because their higher recon value. That's right. So that's something we'll get into later. So up here, we have these interesting tactics. So... I'm actually going to pull up something in the wiki to give you an idea of how these tactics work. Essentially, in combat, at the beginning of the battle and every 24 hours after that, the leaders that you have in the combat will pick a tactic from the list. So the ones that are available, for example, to the attacker, to the default, when you first start a battle at the beginning of the game, the attacking general has these four options. Shock, encirclement, assault, and attack. And the weight is how likely the leader will be to choose these tactics. Now, there's sometimes a trigger. The leader will never pick an encirclement unless the entire frontage is filled. That's the width we were talking about before. So if it has already filled everything from the reserves that it can, and it still has reserves left, and it has a skill advantage over the opponent if he has Panzer Leader or Trickster. Yeah. And his skill advantage over the opponent has to be at least zero, so the opponent can't be better than him, then it will use Encirclement, which is a better tactic because it gives you 25% better attack. It does give 5% better defense to the defender, but it also increases the combat width by 50%. It allows your reserves to get involved in the combat, which is really good because now they can add their firepower. And you can see here there's a countered buy. So all of these have things that can counter them. It'll essentially completely nullify that tactic. And if the opposing general chooses the right one, it'll completely mess you up. So let's look at tactile withdrawal. We'll scroll down to where the defenders are. And you can see at the beginning, we have these four. Defend, counterattack, tactical withdrawal, and ambush. So tactical withdrawal will only occur if the defender has a skill advantage over the enemy leader of zero or higher. Meaning they could, if they're the same, right? If they're both level threes, then the defender could choose tactical withdrawal and the attacker could choose encirclement. And then the defender would be countering the attacker. And you can see this reduces the attacker's damage by 25%. It reduces the defender's damage by 25%. And it makes the width smaller. So tactical withdrawal will cancel the effects of the enemy and apply these bonuses as well. Now, you don't have a lot of impact over these tactics. You're not helping to choose them. However, the decisions you make at a grander scale will. So for example, we talked about how actually another one that's available is the bridge seizing thing during the default. So these four, see, they have no required research. So those are the ones that your attacking general can use at the beginning. But Breakthrough, this one's a great bonus, but you can only get it if you've researched one of these options. So your land doctrines, as you go through them, will open up new tactics for your generals to use that will give you better bonuses, especially for things like if your hardness is over 50% and your general is better than the other guy, you get this one, which gives you 25% bonus attack, them minus 15, and plus 50 to... actually, I'm not sure what that is, now that I think about it. Reinforcement rate. Getting reserves from the reserves into the battle is what that is. So you can see these can be way better if you go deeper into your land doctrine tree. So anyway, I just wanted to explain what those were. I skipped forward a little bit, so the battle has changed. So a bunch of those guys retreated and these guys were attacking. Now, one thing I didn't mention, the combat width was higher before because we had enemies attacking from multiple directions. If you attack from more than one province, you get a bonus. So for example, let's take these three guys and attack into here, and we'll take these guys and attack into here, and let's look at the resulting combat. Well, it's a higher combat width. I think it starts at 80 and it goes to 120 if you are coming from multiple directions. And then you can see that we have this little thing here, attacking from multiple directions. This gives you, allows the front to be bigger. So it lets you take advantage of superior numbers. And we can see here, in multiple combats, ooh, this guy's got a big penalty, because these units are simultaneously attacking here and being attacked. So this guy's attacking and being attacked, so he's got a big penalty. So now we're going to start letting these play out. This is just how the combat window works. This is how you read the combat window. We're not going to look at this too much more. But do you have any questions about this before we move on? Also see the tactics list that they choose. Hello? Did I lose you again?
No, I'm here. I would say yes, I understand it. There's just a lot to look at, but sure. That's quite interesting. Yeah, I like
this
it.
This is just if you're losing a battle and you don't know why, start hovering over stuff in here and try to figure out, oh, the terrain is hurting me. Oh, this and that. So I'm going to go. Now, I gave these guys orders even though they have a plan. We're going to put them back on the plan. So I'm going to have them retreat. So we were talking about getting the planning bonus and doing all this stuff. Now we execute the plan. So I'm going to hover over this. You can see we can execute the plan. And the bar at the bottom of the plan, it's green and then it fills up to red. You can see it's a little bit of red on the right-hand side of those bars.
Yes.
And I can't go down here without... There we go. That's saying force composition. That's the general's estimation of how likely the plan is to succeed based on what we know about the enemy, what we know about the terrain, and our current units and planning bonus. So he thinks we're going to win. So we're going to hit this button, activate. And now the units are going to start doing their own thing. So you can see these units started attacking. These units started attacking. These guys can't attack because they're currently defending. But as soon as that defense is finished, they will probably attack. If we look in here, we can see that if you hover over the attack, these guys have a planning bonus, plus 47% to their attack and to their defense because we spent all that time planning. Of course, that gave the enemy time to get in position and entrench, but that is something you have to weigh. Now let's go and give these guys the order to attack as well. So So this guy is just freely walking into here, so he's got it made. Now, if we wanted to, we could say, no, I want you to go there, but then I want you to come and attack this guy. We can manually give orders to our guys. If we see an exploitation opportunity, or if we see a way that we can maybe cut this, let's tell this guy, oh, the AI keeps moving him back. I'm going to pause it, tell this guy to stay here. Now I'm going to tell him to do this. Let's see if we can, I mean, it's not a motorized unit. He's moving through mountains, so this is probably not going to work because it'll take him like a week and a half to do this, but we're going to try it. So I can give him an order. When this order is completed, the AI general will take him back over and incorporate him back into the plan.
Mm-hmm.
And so let's see. Yeah, how long will it take him to get there? 2 days just to get here, another couple days to get here. So we'll see how that works out. So we're going to let the AI sort of push its way through here. Again, we don't have to do a lot because we have a vast superiority in strength of our divisions, both numbers and each of our divisions is actually stronger. You can see their strength is way low. Either they don't have enough manpower or they don't have enough equipment for their men. Either way, if your guy doesn't have a gun, it doesn't matter how much manpower you have, really. So what we're trying to do is cut this guy off and circle him. If he gets encircled and loses a battle, he won't just retreat, he'll die. Just complete casualty, surrender, whatever you want to call it. Oh, while that was happening, the Rhineland was remilitarized.
Oh, right. It's been a month. This started a month ago, didn't it?
Well, yeah, actually started in January, so I've been sort of letting time tick as we've been going here. So, yeah, it's March of 1936. Ah, worrying. So these are just flavor things, but they're also things that let you know what's going on in the world. The remilitarization of the Rhineland is a thing that the Germans have chosen to do, and it affects the world tension. And we'll go to world tension later, but that's one of the things that it affects, so we'll come back to that. So it looks like maybe we'll be successful over here in our attempt to encircle these units in the bottom, and you'll see what that does for us.
Okay.
I'm going to speed it up a little bit here to watch the combat go. What's the AI doing now? It's moving these guys around. It's keeping them all as part of this order. It looks like it's going to have these guys all push this attack harder, because while we are winning, it's going to take another 12 days for us to finish winning. So it's trying to put extra men into this from other directions, but the combat width is only 80, even though we're attacking from multiple directions, because mountainous terrain reduces the combat width, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. So here we go. We've managed to completely encircle these guys. So now, if we were to go in here, once this happens, they get a 48-hour grace period on supply, and after that, they get a minus 30% penalty to their attack and defense. There it is. 33%, I'm sorry. A third of their attack and defense just disappears because they're out of supply. Big, big penalty. And now the AI has taken back control of this guy, and he's leaving him there to prevent any crazy breakthroughs from any reinforcements coming from the other way. But we can tell him, hey, attack here. Finish this guy off, because let's just make it happen. Now he's in the reserves. Every hour, there's a 2% chance that he'll pop into the actual battle, and that number can be increased if you work on technologies better. Okay, so it looks like, there we go. We won that combat, and it crushed those guys in that pocket. By the way, there's another huge penalty if you have a single province completely encircled. In addition to the out-of-supply penalty, there is a massive penalty for being encircled. And oh boy, it looks like the Spanish Civil War has just kicked off. Let's take a moment to go take a look at that, and then we'll come back here. There we go.
Can you participate in this Spanish Civil War, or because you're the Italians, you can't? You can just watch it.
We can send volunteers to fight for the nationalist Spain. We could actually send volunteers for either side, but we want to help the fascists win because we're fascists. So we could send volunteers if we wanted to, but we have to be at peace. So we can't send volunteers until the Ethiopian War is over. The advantage of sending volunteers is your units get more experience, and you get army experience, and if you help nationalist Spain win, they might join your faction later on. If Republican Spain wins, they're much more likely to join the Allies. So that battle is going to take place. We can't see it happening because we don't have units there, but we might get some intel about things happening, but we won't see it as clearly as we can see this. I'm going to let it run again. We're going to just finish this war up. Now, what causes the war to be won? Let's take a quick look at this. This is the war status button. We can see that Ethiopia is 49% towards capitulation, which is surrender. It controls 65% of its victory points and will capitulate when it has 30% or less. So let's see, where do they have any victory points that we've taken? I think, yes, here we go. So this territory right here is worth 1 victory point. And you can tell because it's got a tiny little square right here. Gondar. So any victory points are always marked by a little square if it's not a lot of victory points, or a large circle if it is a lot of victory points. For example, Neapolis for Italy is a large circle because it's worth 20 victory points. Anzio is a small dot. It's only worth 5. Rome is worth, of course, a huge 40. So capturing the enemy capital usually gets them way closer to capitulating. So what do they have left? Let's see. We took this already, so that's 1. That's 1. And their capital is 5. So it looks like... Oh, and we took this one over here. So it looks like when we take their capital, we will win. They will capitulate. Now, the percentage of their victory points that we need is based on this number here, national unity. Because they have 70% national unity, we need to capture 70% of the victory points that's in their home territory before they will capitulate. France, on the other hand, for example, starts at 30% national unity. Pretty much all you have to do is take Paris and they will collapse. That will increase over time. If you give them time, they will get their disjointed government together. It'll go up to 40%. They will do some things in their national tree that will increase their national unity, and it will be harder to force them to collapse. So the sooner you do it, Germany, the better. That is one of the ways they model the quick collapse of the various factions. Italy starts with a unfortunately low 65. Germany starts with like 80%, for example, and the UK and the US are 80 or 90%.
I see.
Much harder for them to collapse than it is for France or Italy. In fact, Ethiopia has a better national unity than us, I think. Yeah, Ethiopia has 70%. We only have 65%. So we're going to continue. It looks like we're almost on the crux of taking the capital because this is green. That means we're winning. The progress is going in our favor slowly but surely. It's at 90%. It's almost at 100. And we'll add this guy's already part of the combat. You can see we've got one in the reserves, and he could get in there. And if given enough time, he'll pop in there if we watch, but it looks like we might win before he gets to the front line. There it is.
I see.
So now we're moving in. As soon as the guys finish moving into the capital, they will capture it, and the capitulation is right there. So now we have the Treaty of Addis Ababa, and what that means is we can now split up the victory, the territory, by participation in the war. Now, we were the only participant in this war, so we can basically say, take all states. Or we could say, I want this one. Actually, that's a single state. We could puppet them instead if we wanted to. They would be our puppet. They would do what we asked them. We could get resources from them, but there's no reason to puppet them. We're the Italians. We are glorious conquerors of this colony. We will take it. Now,
so if you did puppet them, would they actually grow troops for you to use?
Okay. And they would join your wars, and you couldn't give them direct orders, but they would generally try to help you. And you would get priority access to their resources, I believe. So, you can see up here it shows war score. If, for example, let's pretend that the United Kingdom was helping us and Ethiopia was bigger, whoever did the most in terms of combat, gained the most victory points, that all applies to your war score. So how much you participate in the war determines how much you will get afterwards, how much you can demand as part of the peace deal. So if there were 3 or 4 states and some of them are worth or more valuable than others, we would then have to choose. OK, we only have 50 war score and the UK has 25. You know, which 2 of these 3 states do we want to try to get before them? We would have priority access. And when you're hovering over them, it'll show you what resources the state has. This state has, it looks like, 2 military factories, 2 civilian factories, an air base, and resources, rubber. It has a tiny bit of rubber. So we will take all of it, and then we will hit end turn, and then we will hit done. Italy took 1 state, Ethiopia was completely annexed, and we captured 2,000 equipment from them.
Okay.
Yay! Now what the heck? Go ahead.
Well, I was just wondering how Italy is going to get those resources up to homeland Italy.
Aha, through convoys. So I've gone into resource map mode here.
I see.
Which is down in the bottom right, which you can't see because there's a Team Viewer thing in the way. This shows that there is 2 rubber that is produced here. You know, that sounds like a lot. Right up until we look over here.
Yeah, what is it over there?
848 produced by Singapore. 70 by Northern Malay, 72 over here, 138 over here, 268 rubber over here, 52 rubber over here, 242 rubber. the entire world's supply of rubber is right down here. Sorry, there's a little bit in India here as well. But there's basically no rubber anywhere else.
Do those numbers change over time?
They do not. However, you can get improved extraction technologies that will allow you to get higher percentages. So 848 plus 10%, then plus another 10%. So it would add an extra 84. So the numbers in the map, I think, don't change, but the numbers that you would extract from them if you control the territory would change for you personally.
Okay, based on technologies.
Yes. That is essentially what we got out of there. And because we're in this resource map mode, we can see there's a convoy supplying supplies here. And if we move forward a little bit, it should also show that we're getting... There should be another convoy showing that we're getting resources back. Oh, we're exporting aluminum to Japan, apparently, as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And we're exporting steel to Peru and Venezuela. Supply transfers down to there. I'm surprised. There should be one that shows that the rubber is coming back to us as well, but maybe it has to tick over to a new month or something to show... Oh, maybe that? No, I don't know. But it normally does show where we're getting supplies from. Supply transfers to... Anyway. But that's essentially the convoy would bring the rubber back up this way. Yeah, it says we're producing two, and we're keeping them. Okay. So, that is... how that works. So that's combat. That's land combat. We didn't actually deal with air combat, but let's take a look at how air combat would work had we used it.
All right.
So we've got these little, you might see these little air bases. This one has a circle around it because that means we have planes there. This one doesn't have a circle around it. It has a capacity of 600, but we have no planes there. And we've got another one way down here. So if we click on this territory, you can see that this state has an airbase level 1. That's why you can only fit 200 airplanes. If we click on this one here, that means that state has a airbase level of 3. So you can increase the airbase level, just make more runways, more hangars, in order to put more planes there if you want to. So this one is another level 3. If we click on it, it shows us these are the 3 wings of planes that we have here. This is a wing of close air support. It contains 48 close air support planes. This is a wing of tactical bombers with 32 and fighters with 40. Now, we've also automatically, by clicking on this, we've gone into air map mode. You can see the world is carved up into air regions, and when you send your plane on missions, you will send them on missions within a whole region. So this East Africa region, this entire region is one air region. So we would send them on missions, and I probably should have done this while we were still at war, but we made it to here. So you can click on them. We'll click on all 3, holding down Shift to select more than one. Then we right-click on, or let's see, if we right-click on East Africa, and they now have been assigned to East Africa. If I click over here, we're looking at a different one. If I click here, now we're looking at East Africa on the left, right? So whatever you're clicked on, that's what you're looking at. You can see they're assigned to East Africa. We're looking at East Africa. Now, we can assign them specific missions. Close air support can be used to provide close air support to its ground units, or it can be naval strikes, or it can be port strikes. And you can assign multiple missions, but of course, that you're just prioritizing one or the other. So we would, for example, use our close air support usually to provide close air support, help, you know, kill tanks and strafe infantry and things like that. We could then use our tactical bombers to do close air support missions as well. They're not as good at close air support, but they can still help disrupt the military line. Or we could do strategic bombing with the tactical bombers. Not as good as strategic bombers at that, but still good. And tactical bombers can also do port strike. So naval bombers are best at port strike. Close air support are best at close air support. And strategic bombers are best at strategic bombing, but tactical bombers do all 3. And then, of course, our fighters can be air superiority or interception.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So they can go after enemy fighters or enemy bombers priority, essentially.
Okay.
So now that we've done that, we can also see, unfortunately, due to rain, they are not very good at this. Their mission efficiency is very low. Now the rain has passed, so there's no problem there. However, their range, because these are essentially biplanes here. We haven't gotten proper World War II. Oh, by the way, if you scroll out and we look back on the regular map, you can see storm clouds. You can see little raindrops coming down here. That's showing you there's a storm, and you see lightning there.
Yeah, I was wondering about the weather. Okay, so that's how it's portrayed. Nice.
So you can see that there is storm over there. That's where the lightning is. And it has these negative effects. Mostly the effects are negative to air units and naval units. But ground units also have a penalty to their regeneration of organization. So after they win or lose a battle, they will have lower organization than full because they've taken some hits. And usually they need to take a little time to regroup before they attack again. This makes it harder because there's bad weather. So just rain. I don't know if we have just rain anywhere around this storm. No, it looks like it's all stormy. It's also very hot down here as well. Division attrition is high. So that's the weather there. And that affects the capabilities of the air units. Let's look back at them. So their mission efficiency is very low. But in addition, these guys, because they're crappy World War I interwar level planes, they don't have a long range. They are way up here, and they have to try and do their mission throughout the entire region. If we relocate them to the center of the region, then they will probably make it easier for them. So let's try. So I right-click on that center thing. They're now all moving. So we close this. We click on this one to open it. And now let's see. They're not doing great, but 31% is better than 20%, right? So they're doing better.
Did they lose some planes? Did they fly through the storm? Did they lose some planes?
They have a chance for accidents when they're active in an area with harsh weather.
I see.
So if I did this, these guys are now active, but they're actually not flying because there are no... We're not in a war zone here. There's no enemies to fight, so they're not actually flying. But... the numbers up here would indicate how many active fighters you have, how many active support, how many active anti-air guns, and how many active bombers. And then you'd look over here and see how many enemies are active. So if you're losing the air war, clicking on an air zone and then comparing these numbers is very valuable. Because I, for example, was playing as Italy, and I thought, I don't need to take Malta. I'll defend my fleet with a bunch of air fighters and make sure they always have air cover. So I don't need to build a carrier. And, okay, that's a great plan. I had 400 fighters constantly patrolling all the different air regions here. The Central Med, the Tyrrhenian Sea, the Adriatic, and Italy itself. 400 fighters in each. But then my fleet kept getting pummeled, and I couldn't figure out why until I went on this screen and saw they have 1,200 bombers. It doesn't matter that I have air superiority. We literally can't intercept that many with only 300 fighters. So I underestimated my need for fighters in that particular game. So this air window here, when you go into the air map mode and start clicking around, will give you a lot of good information. You can also click on details, and it will show you how many troops that we bombed, how many ships we bombed, how many fighters we lost, how many fighters they lost. So this helps you see how well you're winning the air war or losing it. It also shows you what your radar efficiency is and things like that. So that is how the air works. Now, it's a little bit tricky because you have to open these and then you have to open this separate window, but you'll get the hang of it eventually. If, let's say, we wanted to add new units. So I've got these naval bombers here, down here, but I want to add fighter cover in the Mediterranean. We got a couple of different buttons up here. You can split this air wing into multiples. So if we wanted to give them different missions, right? I could say this one goes here and that one goes there. That's how you could do that. You can also merge them again. You could give them priority. High priority for reinforcements. The very first naval bombers that come off the line, I want them here if they need it. So when this 48 goes down below 48, when they start taking losses, the maximum 48 could be increased. I could say 104 is actually how many we want here. There are currently 48. As we produce them, they will continue going into this air wing until it reaches 104. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
You're setting how many you want here that can be put here. So this priority indicates that this air wing has highest priority, higher priority than the one that's in Ethiopia. We don't care about that one, for example. We can also reorganize that. Never mind, it's not important. We can also add a new air wing. This shows us the list of air wings that air units that we have in reserves. We don't have a lot in our reserves, but we could add all of the close air support here to this and have them help. Now, unfortunately, you can't click on this and choose its mission until after it's deployed. Now, I just unpaused it for a while. Now we can click here, have them deploy to the Central Mediterranean, say they're on naval strike and port strike. So that's how the air missions work. Now let's take a look at naval. I've gone into the naval map mode, and if we choose our navy, that is, let's see, we've got This is submarines and destroyers. This is our main navy, I think, over here. Let's merge all these together. What do we got? There we go. We've got two battleships, one heavy cruiser, six light cruisers, 28 destroyers, and some subs. Well, let's split off the subs. We don't want them with our main fleet. There we go. Now we can go back to the main fleet. We'll give them a commander, just like the commanders on the land, but instead they get different types of tactics that give them things. So we've got, let's see, a level 3 admiral with superior tactician. Let's go with him. Or a level 3 admiral with superior tactician. I don't know which one. Let's go with Alberto. So we've got an admiral for him. And now we have to give him a mission. Similar to the air units, we can have him convoy escort. That'll keep the formation tight so that 90%, so that their ships are usually very close. If an engagement ever happens, their ships aren't spread out across the Mediterranean. They're close so that a battle will be in your favor. We've also got convoy raiding. They have to spread out a little bit more to find enemy convoys and raid them. That could include supply convoys to and from Malta. It could include enemy supplies of resources. So you could use convoy raiding, for example, if you wanted your subs to patrol the western approaches to try and hit any convoys bringing rubber and oil and steel back to the UK. You can also do a search and destroy mission, which is basically we're going to stay tight and keep all our ships close, but search for enemy warships, not just for convoys. So convoy raiding spreads them out and makes it much better at killing convoys, but if you use convoy raiding and the enemy finds you, your ships will be so spread out, the engagement might be decisively against you. You also have patrol, which is, we are superior here, we're just looking for any enemy warships we can find and we'll spread them far and wide in order to get to it. So those are the different missions you can give your ships. So let's give them search and destroy, and we'll say search and destroy here, and you can also search and destroy here, and we can also search and destroy here. And now we let it tick, and that fleet will just sort of patrol. And you can now see that these three areas have turned green because we have naval superiority in those three areas. The same thing will happen if we were to go to the air map mode. When our air units are flying, we would have air superiority, it would be green. It would, if we have air parity, it's yellow, and if we have air, if the enemy has air superiority, it turns red. So switching to these map modes and looking, giving a zoom out look, where do we have superiority, where do we have parity, and where do we need to send more fighters? That can be very valuable information. If we hover over this, it says, ah, we have naval supremacy. We know there's 40 friendly ships and zero enemy ships because we're not at war with anybody. But that is how that works. The last three things that have to do with organizing and looking at getting information about your military includes the army overview. This allows you to easily look at where your armies are, sort by type, for example. We can see, we can sort, okay, here's all our infantry. If we wanted to take all our mountain units, for example, I could now shift 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and put all our mountain units in their own army. Bam, just like that. So that's what this army overview is really useful for. I can also say, oh, hey, these three guys don't have an army. They're just sitting somewhere not doing anything. So I can click 1, 2, 3, and I could then assign them to an army. This also gives you an overview of all the different types of bonuses that you have across due to technology research and doctrine research. And it also lets you see the experience level of your units and what theater they're in, etc. So you can sort by all these things, find the divisions that you want, and you can see I've got 29 infantry, 5 mountain, 3 light tanks, and 2 cavalry. So you can say, oh, I need more light tanks. I can see this is an overview. It just totals up everything for you. It's very helpful. And you can also see equipment details. We've got this much artillery, this much infantry, etc., 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 in the field. So that can be very useful. So the other one here is naval. This, again, very useful. If you have a bunch of different fleets out there, you can see your total numbers. So you, what do we need to produce here? It looks like we got plenty of destroyers. We could use a few more light cruisers and heavy cruisers. And it also shows you your overall bonuses here, how many ships you've lost, and then equipment details as well. You can also organize by, these are all your fleets, actually. The Italians start with their fleets, just tons of fleets everywhere. I usually like to make one sub-fleet and one big fleet. So I would organize all these and just, okay, take all the subs and just organize them to actually organize by type first. Boom. Find all the subs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now we tell them all to go to one place and merge together. We let them go there. And then we could use this button at the top to merge the navies into one Navy. They all have to be in the same location to do it, so I just have to wait for them to get there. You can see the progress they're all making. They're traveling through land, which is a special tactic that only the Italians can use. And we have one last sub... Let's go faster. Must go faster! There we go. So now that they're all there, I can hit Merge Selected Fleets, and now we have all one fleet of subs, and we can give them an order to, for example, do convoy raiding here, and here, and there. Ta-da! Now we have our sub-fleet doing its thing. So, naval overview, very useful for a very similar reason. You can sort by all these things, you can hold shift to select multiples of the same thing. And air overview, this is where all your air units are deployed. It doesn't include the units that are currently in reserve, but that is still very useful information to see where all your different air wings are. Oh, I have units still in Ethiopia, but we're fighting against the French. Why are these guys over there? We need to bring them back, right? So, those are those things there. So we talked a lot about how we use our units. Do you have any questions before we move on to how we produce new units?
No, it's given me an excellent overview of how to use the units. I saw land battle and air and naval, so I assume that's the major three that we have to work with.
Indeed. And the strategic war is sort of what I described what happens in the naval. You do convoy raiding to try to do, like, for example, the Battle of the Atlantic. For the strategic war, you can also use strategic bombers. You put them on strategic bombing missions in your enemy's area to damage their infrastructure and factories. And, of course, they will try to put fighters on air superiority, and you'll have to send escort fighters, the standard thing. Now, there's one more, there's another couple types of battle plans that I didn't get over before, so we'll go over those real quick. So we talked about how you can have them line up on a border here, right? But what if I wanted to draw a line back here? Let's say we're being overrun by the French, oh no! And we want to set up defenses in the best possible defensive terrain that we can, somewhere over here. Because if you set up your units in a defensive line, so these guys are going to try to hold the line, but I want these guys over here to set up a fallback position and start entrenching now, so by the time the French get there, we'll have an entrenchment bonus. So I'm going to have these guys all join their own army because I had them set up weird. We give them a leader. Don't care who it is right now.
Right.
So then we'll have a fallback line. We can then draw. We're going to draw along this river. Oh, my mouse keeps going somewhere. What are you doing to me?
That's my fault.
The ghost mouse syndrome.
Sorry.
So yeah, I could draw along this river and into a city. That's always a very good defensible terrain. And then we'll draw into this mountain. And then we'll draw down into Genoa, into the city. All good defensible terrain. I can then have these guys all assigned to that fallback line. And if I let go of the mouse, they'll all line up on it as if it was a border. So this is how you can have your guys line up somewhere that is not on an enemy border. You can't draw this kind of line, or that's over here, anywhere but on an enemy border. You see, it won't let me draw in the middle of Italy. That's what the fallback line is for. Finally, when you occupy enemy territory, and the enemy hasn't surrendered yet. So Ethiopia surrendered, so we have no problem with resistance. It can only grow in occupied non-core states. So if we fight France and we start to occupy this area, but we haven't won the war yet, France still exists. Even after France surrenders, if they were part of a faction and the UK is continuing to fight us, the French government in exile organizes resistances against us. So resistance essentially gives you penalties that stack and build over time. So a reason you might want to station troops there, for example, is to lower resistance. The resistance can hurt your supply throughput, damage your factories and infrastructure there, as well as, I wish I had an example because I can't remember what the other things are. It can do a few more negative things. Gives information to the enemy. So any of your units passing through there, if the resistance is high, the enemy will see the exact composition of enemy units moving through there. So it might be quite useful to tell your units, hey, spread out across all of these states and make sure that you occupy all the important places. So air bases, cities, places where resources are built, and factories. Resources is the other thing. If resistance is high, you get less resources from the area. So if you are occupying the Caucasus, for example, and you want all that delicious oil that's down here, if you do not occupy it to keep control of the province, Russian partisans will rise up and prevent the shipments of oil from actually reaching you. So then we would use a garrison order, and we could say garrison here, 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 here. And now all of these units are spreading out to cover all the important places. They'll put themselves inside ports, they'll put themselves inside victory point locations, they'll put themselves inside airbase locations. I might not even have enough to cover all these things, but the ports are very important. So this is also valuable if you wanted to make sure that the enemy could not navally invade you and you didn't want to manually assign everything. You say, okay, quickly garrison this stuff. You guys are my defense, and it'll line them up against on the ports. You could also, alternatively, use a fallback line and just paint the ground along the coast and say, I want you to occupy this to prevent the enemy from navally invading. But often, you only need to occupy the ports and the two or three provinces around them. Okay, so that is, for the most part, all the different tools that you have here. There's also naval invasion orders and paratroop orders. So those are things that look like this. We say go here, and then you're going to navally invade to, you know, down here. And we're going to choose you guys and assign you to it. So now they're preparing a naval invasion. And that acts just like a regular battle plan, only it takes a certain amount of time to plan naval and air invasions. I couldn't execute it immediately like you can with a regular battle plan. You have to wait. So it says 6 of 14 days. It also says we have to wait. We also have to have a certain number of transports. So you can see it says, 5 transports have been set aside for this, and you can see transports in the top here. Okay, so I don't want to go too deep into the more advanced battle lords. You'll learn them as you play, but that's it. So let's talk about production and research. Now, we looked at our units, and you see, well, this one has a tank symbol, and this one has a mountain symbol, but what do those mean in terms of statistics? We're going to open up a bunch of things up here. So these can all be accessed via the QWERTYUNI buttons. Country allows you to set political and military staff. Research allows you to research advanced tank and infantry and doctrine designs. Then we do diplomacy. If you want to do diplomacy here, you can see who likes you and who doesn't. Trade allows you to get resources that you don't have direct access to. Construction allows you to build things like air bases, radar installations, infrastructure, factories, coastal and land forts, naval bases. Production. This is where you produce the equipment that you need in order to build military units, including air, naval, and land. Recruit and deploy is where you adjust your land division's composition and build new units. And then logistics shows you the current status of your equipment. What are your needs? What are your surpluses? So we have a surplus of infantry equipment, for example, but we have a high need for towed artillery. 24 towed artillery should be assigned to units, but are not there.
I see.
And it looks like, actually, we aren't producing any towed artillery. So we currently, our divisions are set up to have artillery in them, but we don't have any in reserve to actually send to the forces that lost some in the fighting in Ethiopia. So we can go to the production window. And you can see here, we have infantry equipment. We're getting about 21 per day. And we're getting 21 per day because we have 4 military factories that are producing it. In addition, it has full production efficiency. Essentially, you think of this as if you set up a brand new factory to make infantry equipment, you hire brand new workers. The first couple of weeks, they're not going to be very good at making this stuff. They're going to learn as they go. They're going to learn how to make it better, more efficiently. They're going to stop making mistakes. So, make infantry equipment. We can see that production efficiency went down. That's because this brand new factory is not as efficient as these other factories. So that is something that we have to consider when we're making changes to these lines. So for example, we're going to start a new production line for artillery because we know we need it.
All right.
And we got this towed artillery down here. I'm going to bring it to the top just to make it easier to see. And you can see we put one new military factory here, but it's got very low efficiency. A brand new line always starts, and a brand new factory always starts at low efficiency. But it will increase over time. So even though we're only producing one artillery per week with this single factory, by the time it gets fully efficient, and let's just, for example, let a lot of time pass, and you'll see, Now it's producing a little bit more per week.
Yeah, I see that.
Oh, we have the Olympic Games happening. This number is going up over time. Now we've almost got 1.25 per week. Now we've got almost 1.33 per week. So it very slowly gets better and better at making that thing. But now, what if we wanted to change this to something else? Oh, actually what we needed was support equipment. Oh, right. We just lost all our efficiency.
Right, right, because you have to retool the factory.
You have to retool the factories. So if you change from something that's similar, you'll retain some of the efficiency. So if you change from a Panzer III to a variant of the Panzer III, you retain a lot of efficiency. If you change from a Panzer III to a Panzer IV, you retain some. If you change from a Panzer III to making Tigers, a completely different type of tank, well, you'll still retain some. But then if you change from Panzer IIIs to airplanes, you retain nothing. You go back to the minimum of 10%.
Now, does this include production of personnel? What about the troops?
No, this is just for the equipment that we're looking at here.
Okay.
So let's go back to making towed artillery. And what I'm doing, obviously, is very inefficient. I'm just switching back and forth for purposes of showing you. Now, what this says is we have 11 of 20 military factories currently assigned. Up to 15 military factories can be assigned to a single location. So we're way behind on artillery, so we could do this. We've now assigned a total of 10 artillery to this line. But you can see there's grayed out factories at the bottom here. That means any new military factories that come online will fill in the gray spots from top to bottom. So let's say I want 2 more of these, and then I know we're also needing a lot of extra infantry equipment to upgrade things, so I'll add a bunch here. So the first 2 new factories will fill in these 2 spots on towed artillery. The next 5 will fill in the infantry equipment line. Then the next X will go blah, 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 blah. So that allows you to plan ahead and not have to come back to this window every time a new factory comes online. You have to come back here and assign it. You can plan ahead. This is what I prioritize. I want tanks. Tanks are the priority. So I click here to make them go to the top. So the first factories go to tanks. By the way, this is also resource allocation. So if we did not have enough steel, for example, to produce all the stuff that we're producing here, then the submarines would lose out first. And then if we still didn't have enough steel, then the destroyers would lose out, then the battleships, et cetera, et cetera. And these guys can go wherever you want as well. So you can see here, we have 0 oil. 0 oil. We require 11 oil. If I were to just get rid of a bunch of factories here. You see, I got rid of the artillery. It automatically filled in the infantry with the extras.
I see. Yeah.
Now, this is saying we need 11 oil. If I assign another factory to the light tanks, now it's going to say we need 12 oil. Because each, in this case, light tanks take 1 oil per factory you assign to it. So even though more factories we're adding do increase the production of light tanks, it's never going to be fully efficient. Not this production efficiency. That's a separate thing. That will always go up. But you can see it's yellow because we take a 45% penalty to the production because we're lacking this resource. So how do we fix that? We got to fix that, right? That we can't do that. But we don't have any oil. There's no oil in Italy. The Libyan oil fields have not been tapped yet at this point in history. So what do? Well, we can trade for it. We can go here.
So are some of the reasons the oil's going down is because those ships are swimming around in the ocean there?
There is no fuel consumption over time. The oil is only needed. Think of it as you're stockpiling the resource up front for what that unit is going to use throughout its lifetime. It's not the best abstraction, and a lot of people have been critical of that aspect of the game.
I see.
But it is an abstraction. And one thing that helps make it more realistic with land armies is when your units move through harsh terrain, they take attrition. When they fight, they take attrition. And you need to replace your light tanks that get removed from attrition. So you are constantly, if you are fighting and moving, you are constantly going to be needing oil to produce more light tanks. So with land armies and motorized, for example, as well, you're constantly going to need more oil for motorized. As you lose planes because they're fighting and moving, you're going to constantly need a constant supply of oil. So you can't just produce a bunch of stuff and then say, ha-ha, I need no more oil because my planes run on not gas. You're still going to need to replace them as they take penalties, or take damage and attrition. So that is that, does that make sense? It's an unfortunate abstraction to keep things simpler, but I expect it might be improved in the future.
Okay. Well, I think a lot of games do that. You buy the unit until it gets destroyed, so it's not unusual.
Okay. So yeah. We still want oil to improve this speed. So we can go to the trade tab, and you can sort by oil or aluminum or rubber. You can see how much we're producing. We're producing plenty of aluminum. We have a surplus of 72. We have a surplus of 23 steel, so we don't have any problem there. We're producing 2 rubber, but we need 1 more, unfortunately. But that's not a big problem. Oil is. So we click on oil. It shows us all the countries that are producing oil. It also shows our trade influence with them. Uh-oh, the mouse is moving again.
Yeah, my fault.
It shows our trade influence with them. And it says, the distance with them is very far, so that's bad. Our relations with them are bad. And support for democratic is essentially how much support they have for us or we have for them or something like that. With the different factions like each other less, depending mm-hmm. upon how much support they have for that type of ideology. So U.S. has plenty. So we'll click on U.S. And you can see it automatically chose a number that would completely satisfy our need. We need 15, it chose 16. What we're doing here is another abstraction. We are trading away the production of our civilian factories in exchange for their oil.
Okay.
So it looks like here the rate is 1 civilian factory for 8 oil. And you can also click on this button to automatically suit your need. So this button automatically sets it to 16 because we need 15. And it says we have 190 free convoys and it requires 12 for this trade. So let's send this trade. And if you were clever, you just spotted this. Oil from the United States, 12 convoys. So we had a new trade route added as a result, because I'm on the resource map mode. That's why we can see it. So right. If the enemy were to try to convoy Ray here, they could hit our convoys and hurt our oil income. And it would be shown on here, instead of getting 16 of 16, it would show like 12 of 16. And if you hovered over it, it would say, 12 of 16 due to lack of convoys, due to loss of convoys on the way. It also shows we're trading away 2 of the production of our civilian factories in order to get this trade. And if we go to our civilian factories, we can see that we are gaining 6 civilian factories because we're exporting some of our own goods. So the way that these resource things work is money is essentially abstracted in this system. Because of the real way it works, right, is, okay, I want oil from the United States, but I need money. So I will sell my steel to somebody else, get money, then with that money, I buy oil from the United States. Mm-hmm. Instead of using money, it just abstracts out money as output from civilian factories.
So it looks like a barter system, not a monetized system.
Yeah, it tries to make it slightly simpler. Rather than adding yet another resource to keep track of between oil and tungsten and manpower and political power and factories and all of these things, you're just abstracting out money as civilian output. Things that come from your factories that the other countries want. Mm-hmm. So, that is how trade works. We are trading away some of our civilian factories to get oil, but we are also exporting our goods. And we are producing a bunch of steel, right? Let's look. We're producing 96 steel, but we're exporting 24 of it. Now, we have control over that. The trade law controls how much of our production we send out. We could switch to a closed economy if we satisfied these conditions. If we were at war and we had a war economy, we could switch to closed economy. Closed economy is we export no resources. And that means we keep all of them. But that means we don't benefit from other nations buying our exports and giving us civilian factories or money in exchange. Or, right now, we have limited exports. 25% of our resources go to the world market, and if people buy them or don't buy them, we don't have access to them. But that means people might buy them, and it looks like a bunch of people are buying them. That's why we got 6 bonus civilian factories. Now, you can see other bonuses to this. Because we're trading with the world, we get sort of efficiency bonuses to our factory and construction speed. We are trading with the world. We're learning things about things. We get research time reductions. If we go to export focus, man, that's a lot. We spend half of our resources to market, but we get the benefits of even more increased factory output, even better research time, because we're more interacting with the world and getting the benefits of globalization, essentially. And then if you have free trade, 80% of your resources go to market and 15% factory output and 15% mm-hmm. production speed. But as Italy, we don't have a huge volume of resources. We can't afford to do this. If you're the United States or the USSR, export focus could be very valuable to you because you have a lot of extra resources to send to the world to gain these benefits. So that's how we trade to get resources. And you do it from this trade window. And of course, trading with the US is all good until they join the Allies and declare war on us, in which, of course, they cut off the trade. So trading with your close friends is often better. The Soviet Union, of course, will trade oil with us until they go to war with the Axis. So getting oil is important. All right. So that is how you gain more resources and how the resources affect the production. So now you can see we have almost doubled our production of light tanks because we now have the correct amount of oil.
Right.
And of course, the more military factories we add, the more oil we will need. So we will have to eventually re-up our deal with the U.S. and ask for even more and give away more civilian factories if we start producing more and more light tanks with more and more factories. So what is the point of producing all of these? Obviously, your close air support and fighters and stuff, they go to your reserves and you can then assign them into air wings like we looked at before. But your land units require a certain amount of equipment based on how you've built your divisions. So let's take a look at this infantry division. It looks like it is two brigades, each of which are composed of three battalions of infantry. So it looks like each of these battalions is 1,000 men and requires 100 infantry equipment. It shows it right at the bottom of that tooltip. So that together means we've got, what, 6,000 men and 600 infantry equipment. But then we've also got an engineer company, which requires 300 men, 10 infantry equipment, and 30 support equipment. But it provides you with a bunch of bonuses. Engineer company increases your ability to attack and defend forts. It makes your river crossing easier. It makes your amphibious assault easier. It makes it easier to move through and defend in forests and hills and jungles and marsh. So engineer company is pretty valuable. And you can see on the far right side, the entire division as a whole requires 6,300 manpower, 120 training time, I think that's days, 610 infantry equipment, and 30 support equipment.
I see.
So, if we were to choose to train a new infantry division, we can then say, okay, when you're done training, go to Venice. Have some fun in there. And then we could even, let's have these guys on the Yugoslavian border. They're our little Yugoslavian army. And you could even say, ah, well, when this guy comes out, I want him to join that Yugoslavian border automatically.
Okay.
And that's why this is purple, because it assigned to the color of the army that we had on that border.
Oh, right, right.
So that is quite valuable. Now, if we hover over this, we can see this guy, we had a bunch of infantry equipment in our reserves, probably a bunch that we captured from the Ethiopians. And we have plenty of manpower, so that's all green. But we lack support equipment, 0 of 30 support equipment. So if we go into our logistics, we can see under support equipment that there is a need for 315 support equipment spread across all of our divisions.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
And we're producing 0.65 support equipment per day, so it will take 481 days to satisfy the requirements and get all of our units up to strength. Until then, the units that are lacking that support equipment are going to be performing more poorly.
Okay.
So we would go into our production and we'd say, ah, well, maybe we don't need so many light tanks. You can see we've already filled our requirement for light tanks. It says total need filled. So let's go down to one light tank and let's up our support equipment significantly. So now, this again is going to ramp up, but we're producing automatically. Instead of 4.5 support equipment per week, we're now supporting one per day. And our logistics is now telling us that it will only take 267 days. But again, as all those factories ramp up, this number will go down by more than one day per day. Unfortunately, it doesn't take into account the efficiency of your factories, which would be really nice. if it actually did factor that in, but it does not. So you'll have to kind of mentally do the math and go, oh, okay, well, the average of all these factories is 18.2%. It's going to go all the way to 50. So it's roughly going to double within the next 3 or 4 months when it fully gets to efficiency. So instead of 283 days, maybe it's more like 100 to 125. That's how much you can guesstimate. So
over but it's here, not that's not a feature it has right now to figure that out.
Unfortunately not. In my experience, right, right. It's not calculating in the efficiency increases. In addition, the yellow bar over here shows you the efficiency of that line to give you more insight. And this is out of the maximum current allowed efficiency. I believe. No, I'm sorry. That's out of the maximum of 100% efficiency. You can get to 100% efficiency only after getting research. The standard maximum at 1936 start is 50%. So the close air support is as high as it can go. It's not going to get any better. And we're producing 6 per... We currently plus have a surplus six. Of 6. We're producing 0.8. And this number here is how many are being sent out to your units. This is much more valuable in combat, because as your units are taking attrition, they were sending back, oh, we need more infantry equipment, we need more tanks, we need more support equipment, because as you're taking attrition through combat, through moving through harsh terrain, et cetera, they're calling in for support. And this shows you an average of how much is required per day. And this is showing you an average of how much is made per day. And this is showing you the balance expected per day on average. So this is a very valuable window to determine how you should change your production during wartime and during peacetime. So our towed artillery, we gave that a bunch. In 116 days, it'll be filled. That's good. So let's go back to the recruit and deploy. So if we were to add a towed artillery to this, now all of our infantry divisions would require 36 artillery. They don't require it right now. So let's save that. And now go back and look at our logistics. We have a much higher demand for towed artillery. Until that artillery gets there, that division isn't going to be fighting at the strength it would if it had all that artillery. It does not fight any worse, as far as I know, just by adding an artillery. It might. You know what? I unfortunately don't know. But it'll take 4,000 days for us to get the artillery. So it's probably not a good idea to assign that artillery there until we know whether we can actually ship it out. Because then it'll trickle in and it won't be effective. And you can see, for example, if we click on artillery and we add this, you hover over the save button, it will tell you, this will require 900 additional towed artillery. We have 0 in our reserves. That's telling you, don't do this. Wait until you actually build the equipment till you assign it. That's very valuable. It'll also tell you how much additional manpower will be required, because towed artillery requires a little bit of manpower.
I see.
So one of the things that you may have noticed here is, as I've been adding and subtracting things, it says cost 5 stars to add. These divisions, when you edit them and save them, require spending land combat experience, army experience rather, as opposed to naval or air experience. You can see your total experience at the top here. Army experience, followed by Navy experience, followed by air experience. Essentially, your generals don't want to change what's currently the situation. We don't want to change the status quo unless you've got proof that something better would work better. So when you fight, you build up army experience. You can also build up army experience during peacetime by having your units exercise. So, excuse me, these guys on the Yugoslavian border, I can tell them to exercise. They will all generate army experience. They will increase their current veterancy level as well, up to a maximum of regulars. So they will go from green to trained to regular. And we will gain army experience. The disadvantage of doing this is that attrition of equipment goes up to 6%. So these guys will be burning through infantry equipment and or support equipment and or tanks, whatever they're composed of. So if we train tank units, they're going to start attriting tanks. If they train infantry equipment or infantry units that have infantry and support equipment, we're going to start attriting those types of equipment. So you have to factor that in. How valuable is it to A, get these guys trained up, and B, gain more army experience over time? As you can see, training these 4 divisions gives us 0.029 daily experience, which is not a lot. But it builds up over time. And if you have a lot of units training, you get a lot of experience.
I understand. All right. Very interesting.
So
there's usually there's a trade-off for one thing or another.
Exactly. This game is all about opportunity costs, balancing your opportunity costs. So you could make this a bigger infantry division, and that is great because it increases your soft attack, your hard attack, your HP, your organization, your defense. It also increases your weight. That determines how many can fit on the front lines. Remember we talked about combat width?
Right.
I'm sorry. Combat width is a separate stat on here. Over here it is. 16. It's going up by a little bit. So if we take these away, instead of being 16, it's 12. So you can fit more of these smaller divisions on the front line than you can if you make them bigger. So the other things that change if we were to make this just a bigger version of itself, supply use goes up and transport use goes up. All of those things are to be considered. Now, why artillery? Let's look what happens if we add artillery. Soft attack goes up a huge amount.
Right.
Soft attack goes up by 37 because it's very good at killing infantry. Regular infantry only increase soft attack by 6. So just adding one artillery battalion is a huge increase in your potential to kill our enemy infantry. It is, however, towed artillery. If you were to add that to a motorized, mechanized, or armor division, it would move much slower. You see the max speed here is the speed of the slowest battalion you have involved. Makes sense.
So towed artillery is not great with panzers.
No. For them, you want self-propelled artillery, which is essentially a tank chassis with an artillery on top of it so that it can keep up with the main group. And we'll show that later. But the one thing you could do is let's look at our tanks. Unfortunately, our light tank division is much more like a cavalry division with tank attachments.
Oh, I see.
So this is why you want army divisions, so you can make changes to this and say, no, we don't want cavalry. We want to change these out and put tanks in instead, right?
But that costs
experience. Now, see that their max speed is currently 6.4 because the horse's max speed is 6.4. The cavalry... Now, oh, we got rid of the horses. Now it's 10. Way faster. Good for exploitation. Good for cutting off enemies from supply. However, as we pointed out before, if we were to put in a artillery, bam, it drops all the way back down to 4. No good. But support companies do not always assume that support companies have trucks with them.
You mean like engineers?
Like, so it's towed artillery, but they have enough trucks to make them move fast. So, like engineers, but we can also use support artillery. Instead of giving 36 soft attack, it only gives 18. And it requires fewer artillery, but it does not decrease our max speed. So you can add whatever you want in support without caring about max speed, but it's not as effective as putting it in the main line, and you can only ever have one of each type of support company. So I can't add 5 support companies of artillery, unfortunately. So you're limited there. Putting them as combat battalions is much more powerful, but also slows you down and makes you a little bit more brittle because you don't have as much infantry in there. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's how all this works. And the way that you set this up, combat battalions, does not really matter. If you put 2 tanks here versus 2 tanks this way, like, and then do this, there's no combat difference. It's just 2 tanks and it calculates the stats.
I see.
However, each of these brigades, the vertical columns, can only have one type of unit. So the first unit, you can choose infantry, mobile, or armored. The second unit has to follow from what the first unit is. So I could produce a bunch of light tanks and do this, and then later on, you would have to choose a new one, let's say mobile, and put motorized. You couldn't put tanks in this battalion. So it kind of limits you a little bit, but there's really no reason you should care too much about how you formulate this. I always fill out my brigades first because sometimes you see it costs a lot more to change the type. It costs 25 to add the first type of infantry and then 5 from then on down the line. So it's often better to just, if you have tanks already, keep filling out the tanks before you start a new tank line. Any questions about the division designer?
No, it seems relatively clear. I'm sure I'd have to play with it to make sure I understood it better, but yes.
Other small notes, it'll show you what the division benefits are for attacking into forest. For example, tanks don't attack into forest well, for example. And if you had an engineer battalion on here, it would show, oh, you're better at attacking across a river, blah, blah, blah. It also shows you the estimated production cost. The reason there's a range here is because there's a range of quality of equipment. If you use basic infantry equipment to create this division, it would only cost a total of 2,500 production. If you use the best one you've got, it'll cost 2,800. And the production refers to the amount of points your factories build each turn, essentially. So, yes, this division is more expensive to produce than an infantry division. Way more expensive. Look at that. Only 300 to 400. So that's something to be considered. It also shows you what resources you need to build that, obviously. And the last thing you can say for this particular division, they don't need to have the best equipment. I only want them using basic infantry equipment. Or you could say, I only want this division using the best infantry equipment.
I see.
Nice little thing up there. Each division template can also be marked as elite or reserves or default. If you mark them as elite, they will get priority on the newest, best equipment and replacements. So if you're fighting on a big front, your elite divisions, if they take losses, they will be replenished first with the equipment that comes off the assembly line, assuming there's a limitation. If you have enough equipment for everybody, then it doesn't mean anything. But if you have a limitation on your equipment that's coming off the assembly line, elite units get it first. And then you could have your reserves or just your garrison units that are just garrisoning occupied territory. You don't expect them to get into combat. They'll get equipment last. So that's how that works. Last but not least in the Division Designer, you can change the symbol. So, for example, this is Division Colonial Divisions by default. They don't have the engineers, and they have the same number of men, but they also are set as reserves. When I was playing as the Italians, I use the down arrow to remind me, hey, this is the division that goes to Africa, because I also would put a special support company on here called a logistics company that reduces the supply consumption of their units, which is very valuable in Africa, not as valuable in the mainland where you have good supply.
So I see.
That is a way you can customize your division so that you remember, oh, yes, I'm going to use this tank blitzing thing for my best tanks, whatever.
I see. So that gives you some icons to help you align your units to certain objectives and missions.
Yeah, it'll help. It's a mnemonic to help you remember what the different units are good for, what you've designed them to do. In addition, you can see this hardness bar. This is what we were talking about with hard attack versus soft attack. Essentially, every time one of the enemy divisions are going to attack you, it rolls a die. If it's higher than the hardness level, it uses soft attack. If it's lower than the hardness level, it uses hard attack. And you'll notice almost all divisions, it's way easier and cheaper to get soft attack. You throw some artillery on there, doesn't cost a lot, you get huge amounts of soft attack. Hard attack is a lot harder to come by. You need to get anti-tank guns, or you need to get medium or heavier tanks to get some good hard attack. So hard attack, usually, the enemy has a lower hard attack value. So the higher your hardness level, because the more tanks we put in here, the higher that hardness level will go. So the more likely they are to be shooting at our tanks, the more likely they are to be using their hard attack, which means it's more likely that they'll be doing less overall number of attacks because they'll have less equipment that can actually do hard attacks. Does that make sense? They only have so many AT guns.
Right.
So that's something to keep in mind as you're building divisions as well. So that's the Division Designer. And now we can see that as time has gone by, we have been producing enough support equipment, and this unit has been slowly gaining it. It's not fully completed yet, and it will never deploy until it's got all of its equipment. You can manually override that and say, no, deploy with part of your equipment. I need you on the front line now.
Right.
You can also see in here their training.
Okay.
You were going to say something?
No, I'm listening.
Okay. So they are training. They start as green, which is the minus 25% to combat. You cannot deploy them until they've reached at least 20%, or is it 25%? At least a certain level of training. This deploy button will be grayed out. And these guys will slowly train over time, and the amount of training they need depends on the equipment. If you recall, here you can see training time 120. If we go over here, training time 180. I believe that's due to the quality of the equipment, not the amount. So higher quality equipment. You're going to need more training time for tanks than you are just for general infantry, for example. So when both of these bars are completely full, and by the way, training is limited to your equipment. So if we only had 50% equipment, the training bar would get up to 50% and then stop until the equipment filled up more.
Right.
So, because you only, if you can only give half your guys guns, they're the only ones that can train with the guns, essentially, is how they've set it up. So, once this you can see 31% of 97%. They can't get to 100 because we're missing this support equipment, which is slowly being reconciled by our production here. Slowly. So, when this unit reaches 100%, it's got full equipment and it's got full training, it will then automatically deploy to the space where I told it to Venetio, and then it will automatically move to the front where I told it to move, which is this front. You can ignore the front thing and just have it auto-deploy to Venetio and come back later and go, oh, I've got these units ready. Click them and send them to a front you want. I can also add another unit. So now this line is training a bunch of units, and you can see we've got plenty of infantry equipment. It's just that support equipment that's holding us back. But now all these units are going to start training. As they get support equipment, they'll come out. Right now, it's got one of infinity. This line is just going to keep pumping out infantry for the rest of the game unless we change something. Or we can say, run this production line twice. So I want 8 total units. You're going to do it in stacks of 4. And then I could train two armored divisions at the same time. Oh, nope, we don't have enough equipment for 2. Let's close that one off and just do 1 at a time. Because you can see, we do not have enough light tanks to train more than 1 at a time. Uh-huh. We might not even have enough light tanks to train 1 at a time at the moment, but I haven't been doing anything with industry, so that's probably the main reason. And we can also prioritize. I want all infantry equipment that comes off the line, say we have a short of infantry equipment, I want all infantry equipment to have the highest priority to go here, produce these guys first, and upgrade the frontline units last. Reinforcements, high priority. Tank production, tank division production, high priority. We'll leave these guys on medium. So if there's ever a shortage of a particular unit, equipment type that's needed for more than one of these things, you can set the priority to determine where it goes first. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
So upgrades is discussing what we're going to talk about next. So we talk about how you deploy your units, what the units require for equipment, but how do you make that equipment better? Factories, but I did a great guide on civilian factories. They can be used to build more civilian factories, more military factories, dockyards, naval bases, forts. So they're very valuable for building your things up. Although you did ask, what were all these things in the bottom left? Those are, so each state in the game is a collection of provinces. You can see I'm clicking on a single province, but I'm getting a bunch of information about the state as well.
I see, yes.
So this province specifically has a naval base in it. It does not have a land fort or a coastal fort. If I click on a different province, that does not have a naval base, but it's still within the same state. All of these buildings up here are statewide buildings. It has, for example, one military factory that's under construction, a civilian factory, some dockyards, and 2 more open slots that I can build anything in. It also has a bunch of locked slots. I don't have access to these. The amount of unlocked slots is based on population, essentially. That can be increased with technology and improvements and things, but in general, it's a population thing. So that's what those mean, and that's what you're building on constructions into those slots. So those slots share military, civilian, dockyards, synthetic refineries, rocket sites, and nuclear reactors. So that's the opportunity cost there. For every one of these things you have to build, you're giving up the opportunity to build another one of those different things. So instead of a military factory, if you build a synthetic refinery, yeah, you're getting oil and rubber, but you're not getting in a military factory there. So that's how the civilian constructions work. But let's talk about very briefly, political stuff. I did a whole video on these, so if you want to go into detail about how political power works, check it out. It's under pre-release guide on my channel, and it shows your 3 laws. Conscription determines how much manpower you get. Limited exports, we talked about that with trade. Partial mobilization determines how many consumer goods you need to dedicate to civilian factories dedicated to consumer goods, et cetera, et cetera. You can assign ministers that give you various bonuses. You can get your general military staff that give you better benefits against air or ground or what have you. So these are all worth checking out. Check out that guide. A much more interesting one is the national focus trees. This is a new, unique thing to this game. And each of the major powers has a unique national focus tree. For example, Italy's tree focuses on, for example, Mare Nostrum, Our Sea. If you pick this one, you can go down the line of getting carriers, capital ships, building a real fleet, marines and landing craft, naval air. Or you can go down the primacy tree and go towards modernized armies and special forces like mountain troops and paratroopers. Also, Ethiopian war logistics is usually one of the first ones you go down because it gives you some infrastructure down in Ethiopia to help you fight that war. It also gives you civilian factories that help you build up your industry and build up your... Then it gives you military factories, research slots, fortifications, all kinds of cool stuff. Then when you get to the bottom of this tree, you can get Libyan oil refineries, which can be very valuable. That is an ahistorical possibility because Italy never developed oil in Libya during World War II. Oil was found and excavated from Libya after World War II. So this has some ahistorical options built into it.
Interesting.
And then, of course, you've got options to support nationalist Spain. These options here, after you have triumph in Africa, they all have some kind of, many of them have prerequisites. This one says you have to own Ethiopia or Ethiopia as a puppet of Italy. So we could not have chosen this while we were at war. We had to win first. Then we gain a base national unity of +20%. Everybody likes it when we win, right? Then you can choose, oh, I want to attack Yugoslavia. I want to befriend Yugoslavia. You can use this tree as a good high-level strategy option tree. If you don't know what you want to do on a high level, what do I do next? Where do I go? Who do I attack? How do I ally with somebody? This political section of the tree gives you really good options. You could go to claim Yugoslavia to attack them, or you can befriend them and use and trade resources with them and get them to join your faction. And then, of course, a treaty with Germany gives you some benefits down here. Or you can found your own faction, maybe with the other Baltic states or with Spain, and fight Germany yourself if you want. Again, a lot of ahistorical options in here. And just to give you a little example, Germany's tree is very different. They have these army innovations that give them bonuses to land doctrine, bonuses to armor research, more bonuses to land doctrine and armor research. And then, of course, strategic versus tactical air effort. This symbol means you're picking one or the other. They have their own industrial side. They have a massive set of options with regards to the political side. And then they have a small tree over here that has to do with their naval effort. They could go for Plan Z to try and improve their navy and make it an actual ocean-going navy, or they could go for the U-boat effort, which gives them benefits to researching of subs. So these trees are really cool. And what if you wanted to play a minor like Turkey? Or Spain? Well, all the non-major nations have what's called the generic focus tree. Army effort, equipment motorized, doctrine, or aviation effort with fighters versus bombers, or naval effort, flexible versus large, industrial effort, military versus civilian, political effort. Do you want to go communist? Collectivist ethos sends you towards communism or fascism, so you might want to sort of buddy up to Germany or the USSR, and then you choose either the USSR or communism or fascism here, and then go down these trees. They give you other bonuses. Or you could go all the way down to the bottom and found your own faction, like Turkey by themselves. Yeah, that's probably not the best. Or you can go liberty ethos, which is the democracies, and then go down these trees to try to buddy up with the UK, or still found your own faction. As you could pick a minor and just try to get all the people joining your faction. A favorite of the developers, because they're from Sweden, is they play Sweden, found their own faction, and get Norway and Finland and Denmark together and found the Northern Lights.
The Northern Lights. The Northern Interesting. Lights.
So it's okay. It's really cool. These And by the way, Poland gets a special national focus tree just for Poland. So that is a little special free DLC that they added to everybody who buys the game. Poland is not considered a major country, but they get their own customized tree, which is kind of cool. They spend a lot of time researching what Poland could have done had they survived. And they could go with the Soviets, or they could go and try to join Germany, or they could try to survive against the Soviets in Germany by going down the liberalism tree. So really cool stuff in there. The last way that you're really upgrading your units, your country as a whole, is the research tree. We looked in here a little bit, but it's got all these tabs across the top. And the main thing to see is you've got the dates across the top. If you try to research something ahead of the date that it is, so we're in 1936. If we try to research something in 1938, you can see it gives you a big penalty, 1.19 years ahead of time. So instead of taking 150 days, it's currently taking 330 days to research. So as far as I can tell, researching something earlier still gets you it earlier than waiting until 1938, for example, to start researching infantry equipment one. Or sorry, improved infantry equipment one. However,
right,
the further back you start, the less benefit you get. So if you start a month early, you're going to save 28 days. If you start a year early, you're going to save 150 days. So it's not as big a savings the further back you go. If you start 3 years early, maybe you'll save 400 days, right? Even though you're starting 3 years early, you're only saving about a year's worth of time. And so there's another opportunity cost because you only have so many research slots. If one of these is used up for 3 years trying to, or 2 years trying to research just one really good, like Tiger tanks, for example, then you're losing the opportunity to get a lot of things that are from the correct year. So infantry equipment.
So it's a diminishing return sort
exactly.
of situation. Yeah,
when you get to be about a month or two away, you can kind of ignore it and say, yeah, we'll just do it. But it gets a little bit more difficult when you get to 6 months to a year out. Now, looking at this, you can see how some of these are rectangles and some of them are squares. The rectangles unlock new types of equipment that you must produce in this production line. Squares give you either unlocking a new type of unit or just give you a flat bonus to existing units. So you should never worry about clicking on a square, which is a weird thing to say. Click on a square, no problem. If you're clicking on a rectangle, you have to have a plan for how you're going to start building that thing. Do you have extra production that's coming online soon? Or are you going to give up production of existing infantry weapons to start on infantry weapons too? Or you say, well, we don't need as many fighters. We have a good amount of fighters. We're going to stop producing them and start producing Tiger tanks, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Keep in mind, when you switch over from weapons one to weapons two, you lose a big chunk of efficiency.
Oh, right.
So,
Right.
And I made this mistake. You do not want to do that right before you go to war with the Soviet Union. That's a bad idea. Because if you have a big stockpile of weapons one, you're fine. You can use them for replacements during attrition. But if you have a small stockpile of weapon one because you've been using your stockpile to deploy more and more and more and more divisions, and then when those divisions get into combat, you have nothing in the stockpile and your production is really low because you just switched over, that can cause problems. So the last one is the special forces down here. These unlock the Marines, Mountaineers, and Paratroopers, but they don't require specialty equipment. They usually just require more infantry equipment than a regular division would, and they require usually some support equipment as well. And then, of course, motorized, mechanized equipment. This little symbol in the top here means after you've unlocked the main thing here, you can unlock motorized artillery, where you put, like, Katyushas, essentially, on trucks.
Right.
And so that's kind of cool. So, other trees here, the support battalions, support companies is what this should say. Remember we talked about the support companies like engineers and artillery?
Yep.
So, artillery, anti-tank, and anti-air are three of them. The other ones all live in this tree. Engineers improve your ability to fight in tough terrain. Recon companies make it more likely that your general will choose the tactic that counters the enemy's general. The enemy general's tactic. Military police, very good for occupying territory. They suppress the resistance better. Maintenance companies, if you put these with your armored companies, you'll lose far less tanks to attrition. Very good.
I see. Right.
Field hospitals, same thing for infantry. You'll lose less men from attrition in combat because they'll be better patched up on the battlefield and sent back. Logistics company reduces your supply requirements, and a signal company increases the initiative of your general and makes it more likely that units will get from the reserves into the main line.
The main line. Mm-hmm.
Then you've got your tanks. They start by splitting up into heavy and light, and eventually medium kind of takes over for the light tree. Because if you look at the light, they move at 12 kilometers. Then the first medium tank goes down to 8. The second medium goes to 9. The third medium goes to 10. So the mediums get better and better at keeping up with where the light tanks would be. And eventually you can make a medium heavy tank that goes 10 and has just ridiculously high stats. But of course, requires a lot of advanced resources. Then we've got artillery, which includes anti-air and anti-tank. Fairly self-explanatory. Every other button here, it looks like, allows you to get improvements to the artillery. Rocket artillery. I haven't really determined how much different... I mean, it says rocket artillery lower sustained rate of fire. I mean, we can kind of take a look at what these do differently. So higher breakthrough on rocket artillery, lower defense, better soft attack, lower hard attack. That's kind of what you're looking at. Hold shift to open multiple of these. So instead of clicking on one, you hold shift and a second one opens and you can slide it along.
Look at them, make them do a comparison. Yeah.
Land doctrine. Unlike all the others, this does not have a date down the side. You can just burn down this as fast as you want, but these usually cost 100, 120 days. Land doctrine's 268 days. It's got a base of twice as much, 300 base. But because we have a reduction of 1%, I guess that's going down. Anyway, these all give flat bonuses, but you can only have one of these doctrines chosen. Mobile warfare is like the German-style Blitzkrieg. Superior firepower is the American style, where you put a lot of artillery and you spend a lot of factories producing a lot of expensive equipment, but you get a big return for it. Grand Battle Plan is the old World War I extension to the World War II tactics, where you get a lot of benefits to entrenchment, but it's also the British style of your max planning. Instead of being a 50% bonus, if you wait long enough, it will be 80% bonus to combat. Whereas the Germans' main thing is they plan 50% faster. So they can get up to that 50% bonus, attack you, attack you, attack you, and then they'll stop for a short period of time. You won't have time to get a breather, and then boom, they'll attack you again. And then mass assault is for China and Japan. China and the USSR is their default tree. And China would go down the mass mobilization, and then the USSR would go down deep battle tactics, usually. But you can choose any you want. Mm-hmm. So, for example, Italy starts with the Grand Battle Plan. They get advantage of starting with trench warfare, but you can start by jumping down the superior firepower. But if you ever want to change, you lose all progress in the other. Naval unlocks naval units that can be built. Capital ships are marked with a little diamond to show you that they're capital ships. And yes, I know it says heavy cruisers are capitals and everybody's mad about that, but whatever. You get carriers. You can also get transport ships. And improved transport ships make your landings, your naval invasions much better. It lowers preparation time. It increases your defense when you're landing. And it increases the capacity each of your transports can have. So then the naval doctrine is just like the army doctrine. You can only choose one of them. And then you go down that tree and that tree alone. Fleet and being is focused on strong fleets, especially capital ships. Base strike is focused more on carriers. There are carriers, by the way, in all of these, because carriers were the future of combat. So you can't just ignore carriers because you went to fleet and being, and it gives bonuses to battleships and battlecruisers. It still has this thing about carriers benefiting you, but it's carriers as a subsidiary role rather than the main role. And then trade interdiction, more of the German-style wolf packs and things like that, but they still get bonuses to carriers as one of the trees here. And way down here, you see floating airfield as an option. Okay.
Wow, floating airfield.
Yeah,
okay.
That's a cool one. It looks cool, too. It's just giant thing. Then you have floating fortress, battleship organization, 20%, and their armor's up 10%. Oh, so good. Anyway, air power. Wow. Oh, I missed something in the armor tree. Remember we were talking about self-propelled artillery? After you research these guys, you can research variants. This is a self-propelled artillery variant. This is a tank destroyer variant. This is a anti-aircraft variant. So, for example, for the Panzer IV, if I remember correctly, Panzer IV and then the tank version, the tank destroyer version is Jagdpanzer, and then the air anti-air version is an Ostwind, and then the artillery is a... I can't remember now off the top of my head. Damn it, I used to know these. Anyway, Airtree does a similar thing.
Has variants.
Yeah. They've built the carrier tree as variants of the main planes. That is, again, an abstraction. Everybody knows that the Zero wasn't a variant of their land fighter. It was constructed as a carrier fighter. But they don't think of it as variant. Think of it as a carrier role for that particular type of plane in that particular year. So you have fighters, close air support, naval bombers, and all of them you can research a carrier version of that role for that time period, right? That's what this button is for. So we have already researched this one. We can click on this, and it'll let us research that particular carrier version of the close air support for 1936. And then, of course, you get down here, and jet engines lock these. These are theoretical jet fighters that you could have if Italy had developed jet engines. Air doctrine, very similar to all the others. This middle one focuses on air supporting ground. This one focuses on strategic destruction using strategic bombers to damage your enemy's factories, and this one focuses on essentially tactical bombers doing both roles, which is kind of cool.
I see. Right, right.
But as I should point out, all three trees give you bonuses in all three areas. It's just that some of them focus more heavily on one.
On one. That makes sense.
So the engineering tree, electronic, this tree down the right-hand side decreases research time. These pay themselves back in about 3 years, give or take, as long as you research them at the appropriate year. So 3% minus across all of your things, in about 3 years, you start making that time back. So researching this by 1942, by you get to 1944, 1945, you start making some headway, so maybe it's not necessarily useful. But branching off of this is decryption and encryption. This is the intelligence system of the game. If you have more decryption than your enemy has encryption, you can see more information about what they're researching is, as their national focus, what national focuses they've already got. When you're looking at units on the border, if we go back to the map, we can see that there are some Yugoslavian units here. We can even see their type. There's a mountain and an infantry and an infantry. And we see a question mark over here. When I was playing and I just ignored decryption for a while, all of this started turning to question marks. I had no idea how many there were or what they were because I was ignoring encryption and my enemy was researching encryption. So that is an abstraction for your entire intelligence system. How much do you want to spend? How much time and effort do you want to spend on your intelligence and counterintelligence, essentially? The left-hand side is radar, and the higher your level radars, the more radar you can radar levels you can fit in a state, makes your air combat better. That's all. Then of course you've got nukes.
Of course.
You basically
better
have
add
to,
rockets as well.
Yes, they have rockets that so that you can create rocket sites in the ground and start launching rockets at Berlin if you wanted to, if you were Denmark, or you could launch them at London as was historical. So essentially, once you get here, you have to start building nuclear reactors in your states, and they will produce nuclear bombs very, very slowly. They have to produce the weaponized uranium, essentially. And then once you get here, you can actually turn them into bombs and drop them. And what they do is they lower the national unity of the place that you drop them on, of the country you drop them on, based on the city you dropped it on. So if you drop it on their capital, which has a lot of victory points, it lowers their national unity a lot. So it makes them more likely to surrender. But they won't surrender at all if they haven't lost any territory. So you have to take some territory from them, then drop the bomb, then they surrender.
So, e.g. Okinawa or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, exactly. If you take some of their home territory, what is considered home territory at the beginning of the game, and then you start dropping bombs on them, then they'll surrender. So the last one is the most important, industry. So this increases your efficiency cap. Remember we said it starts at 50, but it can get up to 100? 5%, 10%, 15%. 20%. Right. And so by the time you finish this tree, you'll have gotten it up to 100%. And then you get a little choice here. Make production efficiency grow faster or have it retain more when you flexibly change your lines. Pretty cool.
Right, right. That makes sense.
This tree always increases the maximum number of factories that you can have in a state by 20%. Both of them do that. This side of the tree gives you maximum factory output. It increases the factory output of all your factories everywhere by 20% every time. It's the same all the way down the line. Oops. This one doesn't give you as much raw output, but it gives you production efficiency retention, similar to this other one that allows you to be more flexible. This one allows you to be more flexible, and it disperses your factories, making strategic bombing against you less effective. So if you're Germany and you're expecting the Americans to come in with B-17s, this might be a better option for you because it makes their B-17s way less effective. So it's a very difficult, and these are mutually exclusive. You choose one of these lines and go down it. Construction just increases your civilian construction speed all the way down the line, and it's very valuable. And if you are a nation that has a lot of resources, all of these branches off to the side give you resource gain efficiency by 10%. So that's how you can get more resources out of the resources that you already have. And lastly, synthetic oil. Each of these levels lets you produce another synthetic plant in each state that you have. So the first level only lets you put one synthetic plant per state, even if you have factory slots available. The second level lets you put two per state, three per state, four per state.
Right, right.
And each of them produce 5 oil and 2 rubber. And as we were looking
at before, rubber as well.
Yeah, okay. 2 rubber, yes. And as we were looking at before, when we were looking at the line, okay, even if you're Italy and you want to produce a lot from synthetics, or you're Germany, you're never going to produce as much as produced from the Caucasus.
Right, right,
126,
right.
26, 18. Like, just take it. Just they get 4. Romania gets 70. Germany's going to want to trade with them or take them over. So that is all of you things we can do with research. These buttons up here will help tell you and alert you, hey, you should draw your attention to this thing. You have free dockyards. We have 11 dockyards. We never assigned them to anything. We can battleships
here. That's
why
you said that was important.
It was going to drive people crazy because you want to make sure you take care of these things before you unpause. I was letting research go by with just these slots empty and nobody was learning anything. You're supposed to have all of these filled all the time. When you're playing.
Right, of course, of course. Yeah, but you were showing me the other
elements.
Exactly.
We weren't playing for real. And this says insufficient resources. It says, oh, here's where you're behind. Maybe you should consider trading for these. And of course, it's saying, oh, you don't have a national focus set. You should set a national focus.
Right.
Because those you take about 70 days, and you want one training all the time, basically. They're very good. They give you lots of bonuses. Until the end,
so
you've got the tree filled
out. As you take care of those items, then they come off the top.
And yes, exactly.
If something becomes dangerous, then it'll put another icon up there you need to look at.
Exactly. And
Well, that's really helpful for new persons, especially.
Yeah. So there we go. We took the last research, and that disappears. It also says you're missing equipment production. We assigned naval bombers down here, if I recall correctly. We said we don't want 48 here. We want 104. So the game is telling you, hey, we're trying to send some there, but you're not producing any. That's what this is saying. You're not even producing any, but you've said you want some there. So this is telling you either fix it so that you're not asking for some or start building some. Pretty cool. Very
is
useful.
Okay, very nice. Very nice. Exciting. It's been a real great introduction to this, I have to say.
Yeah, so do you feel ready to take on the world?
I guess it's coming out tomorrow, isn't it?
Game? Monday.
Yeah, Monday, that's right.
D-Day.
Yeah, D-Day is D-Day. All right.
Oh, actually, look at this. We've got a sandstorm in the desert here. It's very cool.
Oh, looking. Yeah.
The effects of that is air detection minus 90%. Air accident chance plus 6%. You don't want your air forces flying around in a sandstorm. That's very bad. And winter is very bad, too. Look, you can even see this. Look, you can look at the Soviet Union, and you can see it's October. It's already started to be mud season because you can see these brown patches. Plus
mud
70% attrition, minus 50% move speed. Oh, it's awful. It's awful. You'll begin to learn how to read the map. You got swamps, the Pripyat marshes here in the middle. You don't want to deal with that. Oh, just ignore it all over. Anyway, I'm just rambling. We'll wrap this up. Thank you very much, Mark. Any final thoughts?
No, other than thanking you. I really got a firsthand treatment of how to play this game. Most of the essential elements of it, and looks very exciting, so thank you.
You're welcome. And I know that this is probably not the way that everybody wants to learn, just sit down and watch a 2.5 hour long video, but I tried to explain it as in-depth as possible, because I know a lot of people really like those details. We're gonna, and I do have, for those that just want a more overview, a series called a pre-release guide that is available on my channel as well. And you know, I probably should have mentioned this earlier on, because those people that would have wanted that, they're not still watching. All right, we'll end it here. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it. We are out. See you later.